Hello, today I'll be building a boost converter and explaining how it works in a simple way. Now, let's start. An inductor. A MOSFET. A diode. An electrolytic capacitor. Lastly, attach a load and it's complete. Here's the circuit for the boost converter just built. This is the power supply, and this is the load. This boost converter circuit boosts the output voltage to equal or exceed the input voltage. Here is a switch. I used a MOSFET as a switch this time. By rapidly turning the switch on and off, we can step up the voltage. Let's say we turn off the switch here. What happens next? Since the power supply is connected here, the current will flow in this direction. Because the power supply and the inductor are connected in series, the current will increase linearly. The switch is currently closed, so the voltage here is 0 volts. And what happens in the circuit on the right side of the diode? Let's assume there is some voltage across the capacitor. Since the capacitor is connected to a resistor, the current flows in this direction. The capacitor is supplying power to the resistor. The capacitor holds a voltage, but there's a diode here that prevents current from flowing backward. Even though this point is at 0 volts, no reverse current flows. Now, let's assume we open the switch here. What will happen next? When the switch is open, the current keeps flowing through the inductor. Therefore, it goes through this path. At this point, part of the current goes into the capacitor, and the rest flows through the load. As I said, part of the current goes into the capacitor. It charges the capacitor. When the switch was closed, the voltage across the capacitor dropped due to the resistor. But once the switch opens, the capacitor starts charging from the current flowing through the inductor. If you close the switch again, the circuit returns to its initial state. By repeating this switching process, the voltage can be boosted. These are the formulas for the input voltage and output voltage. The time the switch stays closed is T on, and the time the switch is open is T off. Let's assume the sum of T on and T off is constant. It's the denominator here. Let me define the duty ratio. The duty ratio's denominator is this constant value, and the numerator is the time during which the switch is closed. That's the definition of the duty ratio. Then the output voltage is given by this formula. Let's try to calculate the output voltage in the case of this graph. In this case, the time the switch is closed is equal to the time it's open. Therefore, the duty ratio is 0.5. It means that the output voltage here is twice the input voltage. Next, let's assume the duty ratio is 0.2. What happens if we set T on to 20% and T off to 80%? In that case, the denominator is 0.8, so the output voltage becomes 1.25 times the input voltage. Next, let's assume we increase the time the switch is closed. The switch remains closed for about 80% of the time. In other words, the current flows through the inductor here for 80% of the time. For the remaining 20%, the switch is open. This is how the circuit will look. In this case, the duty ratio is 0.8. Therefore, the denominator is 0.2. In other words, the output voltage is 5 times the input voltage. It's 1 divided by 0.2. I prepared the devices for the experiment. The input voltage and the output voltage are displayed here. As shown here, the duty ratio is set to 0.5. The output voltage should be twice the input voltage. Let's increase the input voltage. What happens now? Currently, the input voltage is 10 volts. The output voltage is 19.4 volts, which is about twice as much. Let's increase the voltage further. When the input voltage is 15 volts, the output voltage is 29 volts. So it's roughly double. So far, so good. The duty ratio is currently 50%. If we change the duty ratio, the output voltage should change. The duty ratio is now 40%. 30, 20, 10. It's 0% now. As you can see, the output voltage changes according to the duty ratio. Now, what happens if the duty ratio is increased beyond 50%? The switch here remains closed for a longer period, allowing more current to flow through the inductor. I'm increasing the duty ratio. As you can see, the output voltage is also increasing. Of course, the input voltage has not changed. This is the actual operating waveform. The red waveform shows the voltage across the switch, and the yellow waveform shows the current flowing through the inductor. When the switch is closed, meaning the voltage across it is 0 volts, the current through the inductor increases. And when the switch is open, the current in the inductor decreases. This means that during the period when the current increases, energy is stored in the inductor. And during the period when the current decreases, the energy stored in the inductor gets released and delivered to the load. The duty ratio is currently 50%. I will increase this duty ratio further. Increasing the duty ratio means the switch stays closed longer, allowing more current to flow through the inductor. With a higher duty ratio, the inductor stores more energy during this time. Therefore, the output voltage becomes higher. In this circuit, the energy stored in the inductor is transferred to and accumulated in the capacitor to increase the voltage. During the period when this switch is closed, current flows in this way, which increases the current. However, once the switch opens, the current starts decreasing. Why does this happen? I believe it's already well understood that when the switch is closed, the current begins to increase. Next, what happens when the switch is opened? Originally, the current was flowing through this path, but once the switch opens, it starts to flow through a different path. This one here. The current flows towards the capacitor and the resistor. The fact that current is flowing means this diode is conducting. Let's assume the power supply voltage is 10 volts and the output voltage is 20 volts. As I said, the diode is conducting. The fact that the diode is conducting means that the voltage between the diode and the inductor is above 20 volts. Therefore, the voltage at this end of the inductor is 10 volts, while the voltage at the other end is 20 volts, creating a reverse voltage across the inductor. That is why the current in the inductor decreases. Let's try an interesting thought experiment. There's a capacitor in this circuit. Now, let's think about what would happen if I remove this capacitor. Let's say we close this switch and allow a current of up to 1 amp to flow. 1 amp is flowing through the inductor. Let's assume the switch opens when exactly 1 amp is flowing. Then, since the circuit becomes a simple RL series circuit, the current will start to decrease. And the current becomes 0.1 amp. What happens to the voltage then? The voltage rises quite high. Let me explain. When the switch is closed, it's 0 volts. When the switch opens, the voltage across the resistor suddenly rises to 100 volts. This happens because a current of 1 amp flows through the 100 ohm resistor. Therefore, 100 volts appears where there was originally just 10 volts. Since this is also an RL series circuit, the voltage across the resistor decreases rapidly and eventually settles at 10 volts. So that's how the inductor stores enough energy to boost the voltage. Hopefully that makes a bit more sense now. So that is how the boost converter works. But it's normal to want to increase the voltage even further, am I right? Let me demonstrate it. If I set the duty ratio to 100% and keep turning the switch on and off, the output voltage of the boost converter can become extremely high. Let's try it out. Basically, when the duty ratio is 1, the circuit stops functioning as intended. If the duty ratio is set to 1, the output voltage of the boost converter to theoretically becomes infinite. In this scenario, the switch never turns off. It stays closed all the time. So the current just keeps flowing without limit. This means the inductor is always charging. This is the state where the question is, will the inductor burn out first? Or will this switch here break down first? That's the kind of situation we're dealing with here. By the way, even if the duty ratio isn't exactly 1, say it's something like 0.99999, it's still not a very practical value in a real-world circuit. This is because the current flowing through the inductor and the MOSFET increases to a very large value, which puts a lot of stress on the components. It becomes necessary to increase the size of the inductor, and the switch needs to be able to withstand large currents. More withstand voltage will also be necessary. Because the voltage here will be extremely high, the reverse voltage of this diode needs to be higher, and the breakdown voltage of this MOSFET also needs to be higher. The inductor is quite important in this circuit. I'll show you in practice. The oscilloscope is showing the current through the inductor. As the power supply voltage increases, current starts flowing through the inductor. It's direct current. The switching frequency is currently 20 kHz. I will decrease the switching frequency. The waveform is already rough, but it becomes rougher. The ripple is even more noticeable now. Let's decrease the frequency further. Terrible noise. At 4 kHz, the current has started to flow quite suddenly. The switching frequency is now 2 kHz, but the peak current value has become quite high. The reason this happens is that magnetic saturation is occurring in the inductor. The waveform of the current flowing through the inductor has a gentle slope up to a certain point, but beyond that point, it rises sharply. That is the magnetic saturation occurring in the inductor. The relationship between current and magnetic flux is fundamental to how an inductor works. When you flow more and more current, there comes a point where the magnetic flux no longer increases. This is known as magnetic saturation. Once magnetic saturation occurs, the inductor will no longer function as an inductor. Around the peak, the inductor is pretty much just acting like a resistor with some wire wrapped around it. So how do we address magnetic saturation? The design of inductors is quite deep, so there are various countermeasures. The inductor can be divided into two. One effective way to reduce magnetic saturation is by inserting a layer of paper between the cores of the inductor, which increases the air gap. While this approach results in a lower inductance value, it makes the inductor more suitable for applications with larger current demands. The current capacity of the inductor and the inductance value are in a trade-off relationship. Let's flow current with the same frequency as earlier. The difference is that pieces of paper are inserted in the inductor. When we lower the switching frequency, we start to see more ripple in the current waveform. But even with the increased ripple, it doesn't look like the inductor is entering magnetic saturation. Let's lower the frequency further. It's quite noisy. Magnetic saturation is not occurring even though I set it to the same frequency as before. With this frequency, you can see a slight magnetic saturation. Let's change the amplitude and lower the frequency. As you can see, magnetic saturation is happening now. So what I've been talking about so far is the case where the current through the inductor flows continuously as shown in this graph here. It's called the continuous current mode. This formula of the relationship between output voltage and duty ratio only holds true in continuous current mode. There is actually another operating mode in addition to the continuous current mode. It's called the discontinuous current mode. In the mode, the current flows discontinuously in the inductor. Let me explain. The switch is closed now. Once the switch opens, the current decreases and becomes zero. This state continues for a while and then the switch closes again, allowing current to flow. The switch opens and the energy is transferred to the capacitor. During these periods, no current is flowing. A mode with such periods is called the discontinuous current mode. When the inductance value is low and the switching frequency is reduced, or when the load resistance is high, which means the load current is low, the circuit will enter discontinuous current mode. In the discontinuous current mode, the output voltage is slightly higher than the value found by the formula written here. This formula for the continuous current mode cannot be used for the discontinuous current mode. Just keep that in mind. So how is this boost converter circuit used? It's actually used in a variety of applications. Rather than being used as a standalone boost converter, it's often combined with other circuits. One of the most common uses is in power factor correction circuits. You'll find it in home appliances, switching power supplies, and even in modern high power USB chargers. It's also sometimes used in onboard chargers for electric vehicles. This is an example of such a circuit. Here we have a full bridge rectifier, and this part is the boost converter. It regulates the power factor and controls the amplitude of the current coming from the power supply, and this control is handled by the boost converter. Turning the switch on and off rectifies the current flowing through the inductor. Even though the waveform becomes a bit jagged, a full wave rectified current flows through the inductor. Then at this point in the circuit, a jagged rectified current also flows, just like the one through the inductor. Naturally, the current flowing through the inductor is direct current. So that's how a boost converter can be used in practice. Thank you for watching.